Gurur Brahma, Gurur Vishnu, Gurur Devo Maheshwara, Gurur Sakshat Parabrahma, Tasmai Shri Gurave Nama, Akhanda Mandala. Tarpalam darshitam yena tasmai shri gurave namaha Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo namaha Hari Om
laptop. I think this is our first live satsang after what, 1 year almost? Must be a year actually.
March 8th.
Nice, good. So today's satsang is basically to celebrate a memory which is very precious to me. 2 years ago we were at the Kumbh and I had my Sannyas Diksha on this day, and so many of you were also there, so it really feels good to celebrate it with all of you. So I thought, what can we do? For a long time is for many days, I was wondering, what shall we do? We'll meet, but what shall we do? Because I didn't want to do Bhagavad Gita and everything. So I found one, Swamiji had taken this topic 2013, and I remembered it, so I said we'll do the same topic because it's very pertinent to today's celebration. It's called Kaupin Panchakam, and it's all about how a sannyasi lives his life. So we'll sing it first, we'll chant it, and I hope all of you have a pen or pencil with you, so that, because there are going to be questions which you'll need to write down. Okay, so it's a little interactive. If someone doesn't have a pen, just ask for it, and we've got a few extra ones. I'll chant it, I think, because you all don't know the, but you all will get it.
Vedantavakyeshu sadaramanto dikshanamatrena chatushtimanta ashokavanta karunekavanta kaupinavanta kalubhavanta Nātam namadhyam nabahi smaranta kaupinavanta kalubhagyavanta panchaksharam pavanam uccharanto patim pashuna maridi vayanta piksha Kaupinavanta khalu bhagyavanta Kaupinavanta khalu bhagyavanta.
As you can see, it was created by Bhagawan Adi Shankaracharya. And Kaupinavanta khalu bhagyavanta, also called Yati Panchakam. Kaupin Panchakam is also called Yati Panchakam. Kaupin is basically the loin cloth that the sannyasis wear, langoti which we say. And here it stands for simplicity, symbolic of simplicity. Yati also means sannyasi. So either it is Kaupin Panchakam, sometimes it is called Yati Panchakam. Panchakam, you know, a composition of five verses. Ashtakam also we have so many. Ashtakam, eight verses. Panchakam, five verses. So I chose this Panchakam for two reasons. One is it's short, we can do it fast, five verses. And since I am also in the sannyas category now, so how does the sannyasi live? Why would it be of interest to you how a sannyasi lives? Because this Panchakam is not just to tell you how a sannyasi lives or how a sannyasi thinks or what is his lifestyle. It's actually for mumukshus. It's for sadhaks to become mumukshus and eventually take sannyas. So what would it entail? What is the journey? How would a sadhak prepare himself? What would he need? What are his qualifications? What would he need to do or be or think if he were to take sannyas? So it's a preparation for sadhaks, if they ever want to take sannyas. So as we read just now, the last line of every verse is what? Kaupinavanta khalu bhagyavanta. Kaupinavanta, the wearer of a loincloth. The wearer of a kaupin, basically a sannyasi, renunciate, one who has renounced sansar, and he will be a simple person. According to the sans which I've heard, Vedant doesn't glorify poverty. In Vedant, it is not necessary that you have to be poor. Poverty in the sense of material poverty, not necessary. Simplicity. And if you are forced to give up your wealth, then you are in poverty. But if wealth is falling off without any attachment, then it is simplicity, basically. So here we are taking it as simplicity. Bhagyavanta, the one who has a good bhagya, good fortune, good, we say na, bhagya bahut achha hai. So normally when we say that means what? Ghar bhar achha hai, gaadi baadi hai, naukar hai, chakar hai, everything. Bhagya bahut achha hai uska. We think that he's very lucky. He's born with a good bhagya. So he can have lot of vishay bhog. It's easy for him to have vishay bhog. But here, it doesn't mean that. Here, Bhagyavanta means he is fortunate that he is not attracted by vishayas. That is his Bhagya. And what else is Bhagya? That his Buddhi has got Vivek, Vairagya, Shat Sampati, that inner wealth, not outer wealth, Mumukshatva, That bhagya he has got. And therefore, he can attain knowledge. That bhagyavanta. And you know, outer wealth, gadi, shadi, whatever we were saying, that you get by prarabdha. If you have prarabdha, you will get it. If you don't have prarabdha, you will not get it. No matter how much you work or you don't work. Prarabdha mein hai toh, gadi, makan, all this, jewelry, gold, shold, whatever. It's in your bhagya, you will get. But inner wealth, spiritual wealth, by purushartha. So what you are doing so much mehnat for outer wealth, but it is there in your prarabdha, you will get it. And if it's not in your prarabdha, you will not get it. But what you have to actually work for, spiritual wealth, that we are not doing. Because that is our purushartha. Then one word is there, khalu. Kopinavanta khalu bhagyavanta khalu. Pakka. Definitely, really, no doubt about it. So, Kaupinavanta khalu bhagyavanta, the wearer of the loincloth is truly very fortunate. Truly very fortunate, right? Because he has done his purushartha and he has trained his buddhi to attain all the inner wealths. And because of the inner wealths, he will attain the highest knowledge. And most important, because of that, he is no more attracted to Vishaya. Alright, so this is all about a sannyas. So what makes a sannyasi? Is it this orange dress? Is it a mala? Is it an ashram where you live? What makes a sannyasi? What is it necessary? If all this is necessary, then there is no point in my telling all this to you. Because none of you are ready to wear this dress and live in an ashram with one mala. No, a sannyasi is not about what you wear or where you live. It's about how you think. What is your mindset? What is your attraction? Where is your attraction? That is what makes a sannyasi. That's what makes a... It's a swabhav. It's a temperament. It's your conduct. It's your behavior. It's your acharan. That is why Janak, he was a king. He had a kingdom. He had wealth. He had praja. But he was a sannyasi. He was a renunciate. Because of the way he thought, the way he behaved and his acharan. So where you are, ashram or home or where you are is not important. How you are is important. How? So, as we will go through these five shlokas, there will be some lakshans. And I'm telling you right now, there are 15 lakshans. So, there are two ways to take it. One is, you just understand this is how a kaupin vanta, a wearer of a loincloth is. Or you can take it as your guiding line of what all you need to practice, or what are the clues, what are the checkpoints of your spiritual progress. How attached are you or how detached are you? So as you will see how the Kaupin Vanta is, then you can write. I'll give you the prompts, I'll give you the checkpoints, okay? So let's go to the first shloka. Now you all know how to read it and you know the chand also, so we again chant only the first shloka.
Vedanta Vakyeshu Sada Ramanto Dikshana Matrena Chatushti Manta Ashokavanta Karune Kavanta Kaupina Vanta Kalubhagyavanta.
First line. Vedanta Vakyeshu Sada Ramanto. Vedanta Vakyeshu. The person who has a renunciate's bent of mind, a sannyasi bent of mind, what is always going on in his mind? He is always delighted, ramanto, he is always delighting in Vedanta Vakyeshu, in the teachings of the Vedas. He remembers the teachings of the Vedas, and with that only he is happy, he is delighted, he is in masti. And does it mean that the whole day he is sitting like this and doing jap of the Mahavakya? No. Whatever he is doing, in whichever activity he is, he may be cooking, he may be working, he may be doing seva, he may be doing anything, he is always in the presence of the Mahavakyas in his mind. And he is delighted with that. Delighted with that. So for most of us, where is our mind engrossed? Most of us in some matter of sansar, right? Because there is so much to do in sansar, we have so many jobs and so many roles to play. Continuously our mind is in sansar. So for us the line would read what? Sansara vakyeshu sadaramanto. So we are not in Vedanta Vakyeshu, we are in Sansara Vakyeshu. We have bucket list, we have to-do list, we have worries about future, we have regrets about past, we have children to worry about, we have family, business, so many things going on in our mind. So whatever is foremost in your mind, it will come up no matter what. Even if you are in a satsang, that mind will go back to the business, mind will go back to the children, mind will go back to the issues. So Swamiji once said that he was taking one katha in Prempuri, and after the thing, we go to do pranam to Swamiji. So one man came and he did pranam and he said, Swamiji, aapka hairstyle galat hai, aapko aisa rakhna chahiye. So Swamiji said, aap nyai, what is it, nai hai kya?
Baba ji, nai, nai,
nai, nai, nai, nai, aap nai hai kya? Aapko kaise pata? To nai hai, isiliye to aapka mind udhar hi ja raha hai. So, katha is going on, Bhagwan Krishna's leelas are going on, this is going on, that is going on, satsang is going on, bhajan is going on, but his attention is where?
Hairstyle.
So whatever we are, you know, busy with, no matter we'll be in satsang also, mind will be going gadgad over there. So if your mind is continuously in sansar, then we will be sansari only. But if our mind is continuously in Vedanta teachings, right? Such a person we call true sannyasi, khalu, true sannyasi. And not just because of the dress you're wearing or the mala you're wearing, all right? And there's a word sada, continuously, constantly, not just while you're doing puja or not just while you're in satsang. Sada means continuous, it's going on background. So you need to write now checkpoint. Now this is your homework. Find out, where is your mind centered? Sansar or Vedant? Then also see, how much of the 24 hours in sansar? How much of the 24 hours in Vedant? And you know, just because you're doing puja doesn't mean your mind is there. So while doing puja, check where is your mind. Where is your mind when you're eating? Where is your mind when you're discussing matters in the family? You know, when Swamiji was 12 years old. He was taken by his Dada Guru to one Bhakt's house. There was some part was going on for Bhagavad Gita. And you know, in Bhagavad Gita, there is one verse where it comes as sparshanam, this thing that I think while you're eating, when you're talking, when you're walking, when you're this thing. So they had just finished doing that part. And then bhog, prasad was being served. So 12-year-old Swamiji was happy eating the prasad, and he was eating kheer at that time. And his Dada Guru was next to him. So while he's eating the kheer and enjoying really, Dada Guru asked, "Man mein kya hai? What are you thinking of right now?" 12-year, and in front of everyone. 12-year-old boy, "I'm thinking of kheer. What else I'll be thinking of? Enjoying kheer." You just read, your mind should always be in Bhagwan. When you are eating, drinking, walking, what happened to that? So these are the things, you know, you when you stay together, continuously the Guru can bring you back to center. Otherwise, once a month or twice a month, then progress is very difficult. Like this, continue, sada, 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 sada. Continuously you have to, someone has to bring you back on track. Second line. Bhikshanamatren chatushtimanta. Bhikshanamatren chatushtimanta. The one who is totally satisfied, santushta, tushti means santushta, with what? With whatever he gets in his bhiksha patra, in his beggaring bowl. Just content with that. We are over concerned about our future. We have more than what fits in a begging bowl. We have cupboards and cupboards full of stuff, kitchen full of food. The sannyasi, one bowl, and he gets that for the day, and he is santushta. We keep working harder to get wealth, to get things, comfort, vishais. Every moment we are busy procuring, getting. And because of that, our every moment is going in that. Even when we are not at work, at home also, we are thinking of our meetings. We are thinking of our deals, we are thinking of our bank balance, we are thinking of this. Where is the time to acquire Paramatma? Where is the time to pursue our spiritual goal? Even puja, time milega to karte. Or if possible, then we delegate it to somebody else also to do. Now, when you all took diksha, I told you all, do one japmala. Hardly anyone has felt the need to do more than one japmala. One japmala bola, to itna kiya ho gaya. And that too you all do because I have told you to do. And sometimes I know there are people who don't have time to do that also. One japmala. Where there is no calling or there is no pull, ke can I do more? Ek karna hai na. Chalo karke niklo, kaam pe jao, do this, do that, phone karo, have that desire to be with the jap, to be with the mantra, to be with that feeling, it is not happening yet. That means sansar is pulling you out of that. So these are the things we have to think of. We are doing sadhana that the Guru has told you to do, and that's it. There is no pull from inside, ke let me do some more, or should I feel like doing more? Some people have asked me, can I do more? Oh yeah, you can. But most people are just happy doing the bare minimum and getting up. Done with it, finished, it's over. Day can start now. Your day starts when this one thing is over. Strangely, for what you are leaving the japmala to go and do, you will get it anyway with your prarabdha. But what you are leaving to do, you will not get, because for that purusharth is required. So, this 5 minutes, how long it takes to do one japmala? How long? 5 minutes? Maximum? Maximum? So that 5 minutes of sadhana, it's like taking one thimble, you know, which you wear on the finger for stitching and all. It's like taking a thimble and trying to fill the water from the ocean. One thimble, you're trying to get the water of the ocean. How you'll get that bliss of Paramatma with that one japmala, tell me? Not possible, huh? So there's this story, I'm sure you have heard of it. I think it is from Adi Shankaracharya only. He took one of his disciples, his shishya, and they were doing padyatra. You know how Bhagawan Adi Shankaracharya did padyatra of the whole country. So at one place, he told one of his shishyas that in this place there's a lovely tree. You sit here and you do your jap, you do your sadhana. It was out in the wilderness. There was one little thatched roof near a tree. You sit under this. Anyway, you are a sannyasi. You don't need anything more. I am continuing my padyatra and I will come back for you. So it will take a few months. Till that time, you sit here and you do your sadhana. One, how much he had with him? He had his one langot. He had his one bhiksha patra. And he had one stick or something they carry. That's all. You don't need anything else. You don't need food. You don't need anything, because you have to go into the town and you have to beg for your food. Sannyasis have to beg for their food. And he left. So this shishya, he started doing jap 1 or 2 days, 2 days. Then he found that in the night, the rats used to come and eat his langoti, his loincloth. So now, the next day, then he didn't have any loincloth to wear. Every time it would, you know, the rats would eat it. So when he would go to get food, he would say, ask for food, bhiksha, bhiksha, and one loincloth also. Give me one. Every day, one loincloth. So the town people, the village people, they said, ye kya, roj roj ek ek langoti. So every day, they gave him 2-3 langotis. Pakdo, you know, it will stay with you for some time. Then they said, still it would keep getting eaten by the rats. So they got fed up. Then they said, now you keep one cat. Keep one cat, the cat will eat the rat, and we will not have to give you langoti every day. So he kept the cat. But the cat needed milk. So he would now beg for food and little milk. The villagers got fed up. Every day you want us to give milk, milk, milk. Now you keep one cow. The cow will give the milk for the cat. So one cow came, but it was out in the jungle type, na? There was nothing for the cow to eat. So like this every day, then they came and gave grass for the cow. Then grass would get over, again they would have to come and, so they gave him a plot of land. They gave him a plot of land, now you do some kheti bhari and you grow your own grass and you grow your own crops. Now, how he'll do so much work by himself? He's a sannyasi, he has to do jap. So some laborers were brought in. Now the laborers had to live somewhere. So the town people said, chalo, we'll build you a house where you can stay. Rats also will not come. Here is a tabela for your cow. And now he was well settled. Small thatch roof became a mansion where 7-8 people could stay. Cow was there, the cat was there, rats were not there, and kheti bhadi, everything was like growing crops and everything.
Life set.
Now, Adi Shankaracharya comes back from his padyatra. You see, where is that tree and where is that kutya where I had kept my shishya? he could not find. Instead of that, he found one big mansion and one big garden and one kheti and crops and cow and everything. He knocked on the door. Hare, he could not even recognize his own shishya. What happened? Then he hit his head like that. How people do like this? For one kaupin, for one loin cloth, I have lost my spiritual path. Lost. This is how sansar pulls you out. Pulls you out. For one kaupin, I had to get a cat, then I had to get milk, then I had to get cow, then I had to get grass, then I had to get field, then I had to get laborers, then I had to get mansion. Where is it? Gone. Finished. So, second checkpoint. Are you content with what you have? How much time are you ready to devote to sansaric needs and to spiritual needs? We are just going through life, huh? We are not thinking of these things. Alright, now don't think now, you have lots of time to think about all this. Third line. Ashokavanta Karune Kavanta. Ashokavanta. Ashok. Shok is what? Sorrow. Ashok, no sorrow. The renunciate does not grieve for himself. Most of us grieve for who? Ourselves. We don't grieve for other people, we grieve for ourselves. But the renunciate does not grieve for himself. Yet, Karune Kavanta, he has compassion for others' dukhs. For his own dukh, he does not grieve. But for other people's dukhs, he is full of compassion. A renunciate is fully focused on his goal. Sada ramanto. Sada? Sada ramanto. When he sada ramanto in Vedanta Vakyeshu, remember first line? Then where is the time for him to focus on his grief, focus on his sorrow, focus on his dukh, focus on all the things that are going wrong? And believe it, even for them, there are situations which are dukhi. They are still in sansar. They are not living in some ivory palace. They are still living in sansar, so they will also have dukhs, but he has no time for that because his mind is sada ramanto, where in Vedanta Vakyeshu. Okay? Not only he doesn't have time, but there is no space also in his mind for this dukh because he is sada ramanto. If he gets little spare time, what will he be doing? Karune Kavanto. He is full of compassion, solving other people's problems. And there are two ways if you want to overcome dukkh. Two ways. One is with Vivek. Your full focus is where? On your goal. So you have no time to devote to dukkh. Aayega jayega. As it came, it will go. So you use your vivek. This is important for me. This is not important for me. Dukkh is temporary, na? It comes, it goes. But anand will be permanent. So what should I focus my time on? On my temporary dukkh or on my permanent anand? And second, titiksha. वो जाता नहीं दुख तो यू जस्ट बेर इट बिकॉज यू नो व्हाई यू हैव टू बेर इट इज योर ओन प्रारब्ध इज योर ओन प्रारब्ध ग्लैड एक्सेप्टेंस बेर इट तितिक्षा So what makes a sant not feel dukhi? They are in masti. They are in masti of Paramatma. He knows that, you know, if you're getting something so beautiful just by bearing the small inconvenience, you bear it, no problem. Today I was making chutney, coconut chutney to eat with dosa. So I had to break the coconut. So you know, when the coconut is fresh, it's very difficult to break that nut, the outer shell. Because when it is fresh, the kernel, the meat of the coconut is stuck to the shell. But when the coconut has become a little old and dry, the inner part separates from the shell. It's dried up, right? Then it's easy to break, correct? When it is stuck to the shell, it's very difficult. So we are still stuck to the shell. We are still stuck to sansar. That is why it is so difficult to break the ahankar. That thought came to me when I was banging away at the shell. When we will become mature, when the sansar will dry up, then one fatka and this ahankar shell will burst open. Tod diya we sing, tod diya. So, fresh coconut, we need to become a little bit more mature. So think now, third checkpoint. Are you dwelling on your dukkhs? That thing happened to me 10 years ago, this thing is happening 5 days ago, this thing is happening, this is happening, that is happening. And it will keep happening. It will keep happening. So how you are going to continuously dwell on that? It's happening. Aayega jayega. Don't worry about it. Don't dwell on it. You know that when you think of something, you energize it. You know that, right? So when we keep dwelling on our dukkh, what are we energizing? Dukkh, more dukkh. So what should you do? What should you do?
Focus on the higher.
Pratipakshma.
Yes, sir.
Focus on the opposite. Instead of continuously saying this person is treating me badly, this person is treating me badly, this person is treating me badly. This person is beautiful. This person is wonderful. You energize, you put the correct thing that you want. Remember, that's the time. That is the time when the dukkha is like staring at you in the face. That's the time where you have to put witnessing and glad acceptance into practice. So second checkpoint, are you practicing witnessing and glad acceptance? So, if you go take all the three lines of this first verse, you would be a Kaupinvanta, you would be a wearer of a loincloth, or you would be a renunciate if your mind was always engrossed in Vedanta Vakeshu, in Vedanta teaching. That you would be. Or if you were totally content with whatever you had, then you would be a renunciate. Or if you are not dwelling on your own dukkhs, but you have compassion for the dukkh of others. Then Vedanta Vakyeshu Halu Bhagyavanta. So that's three checkpoints for you to see. You think this is useful for you?
Yes.
If not, then we can stop now. Second verse. Mulam taro kevalamashrayanta pani dvaye bhoktu mamantrayanta kantham api sri miva krisyayanta kaupi navanta khalu bhagyavanta. Don't think that all this, what we are saying, has to happen immediately. It can't. Let's be honest about it. So take one thing and see where you would like to put in little bit more purushartha. Like that, slowly, slowly, slowly. It's not for discouraging you. It is for encouraging you to try something which I think all of you are capable of doing. Otherwise, you wouldn't be here also. So, Moolam Taro Kevalama Shrayanta, living at the foot of a tree for shelter. Now, does it mean that you have to leave your house and go and sit under a tree? Definitely not. You know that there are Avdhut Koti sons and then there are Acharya Koti sons. Avdhut Koti son, they are just absorbed. They are just living like this, under a tree, sometimes under a mountain, on a mountain, somewhere near a river. They don't engage with sansar at all. Acharya Koti son will be having an ashram. He probably has built a mandir. He may have built a vidyalay. He may be having people with him. He's teaching. So he's engaging continuously with the society. So living under a tree is actually symbolic. It's not literally living under a tree. What it means is, imagine now, just like, for the sake of imagining, you are living under a tree, let's say. So now how many things you will have? Will you have a sofa? Will you have a wardrobe? Will you have a dining table? Would you have a four-poster bed? No, you will basically have the bare minimum that all fits in one potli, because you know you're just going to pack everything up and then you have to go into the village to beg for food. You can't leave stuff around. So living under a tree for shelter means you're living with the bare minimum that you require. How many things we need to live? So is it wrong to have things?
No.
No, it's not wrong. That is not wrong. Being attached to those things is the problem. But don't forget, it's a very thin line between the two. So what can we do? We are living in homes. So live in your home as if you are living under a tree. Live in your home as if you are living under a tree. We can live in sansar. There is no problem living in sansar. So long as you are not drowning in it. See, a boat can float in water without a problem, so long as the water is outside the boat. But if the water comes inside the boat, if the sansar comes inside you, then like the boat, we will also drown. So keep the sansar in its place. Don't let it drown you. Don't let it come into you. And I was thinking, this line could also mean something else. Sitting at the foot of a tree for shelter. Take ashray from your guru. The guru is there, you're sitting at the foot of the tree, sit at the foot of the Guru. Because sitting at the foot, sitting down, that's the meaning of Upanishad. Sitting down at the feet of the Guru. Why? At the feet, humility, and water always flows from up to down. Water cannot go this way. Similarly, knowledge also flows from up to down. So sitting under the tree, living at the foot of a tree for shelter, live at the foot of your Guru for spiritual shelter. Get the knowledge. And in order to fill a glass of water, there should be space in the glass, na? If the glass is already full, to kahan se jayega andar pani? Similarly, we have to also empty ourselves if we want to get the flow of knowledge to come inside us. We are already with so many preconceived notions. We are already so much full of this gyan and that gyan, and we are going to all places to get more gyan. YouTube dekho, ye dekho, iska pravachan dekho, iska ye dekho, uska wo dekho. You're full. You're full. Now, kahan se jayega andar? There is no place, gyan, there is no place for the gyan to ghuswa inside. Empty this. I tell you, you empty this, sit there, it will flow. So for that, you have to empty. For that, you have to sit. There is the time to sit also. There is no time to sit. So all these things, we have to be careful. Because if we want to progress, then we have to make some changes. You cannot keep doing the same thing and expect to get some different result. Some new purushad. And I'm inspiring you a little bit. Maybe I'm sounding harsh, but I'm not trying to be harsh. I'm trying to show you different ways in which you can make one minor change and one new horizon will open. One new thing will open. One new, you know, expanse will open for you. So, how attached are you to your belongings? And to check this, na, you should see if your house help breaks something in your house, how do you, what is your reaction? If your child puts an ink spot on your sofa, what will be your reaction? If some of your dhobi burns your favorite kurta, what will be your reaction? If your colleague or your employee does some blunder in business, what is your reaction? How are you attached? What is your attachment? Do you lose it because of an object which is broken or scratched or torn or stained? Think about it. Are you a boat in the water, or has the water come into your boat? Check, check, check. Everything has to be checked. If we don't check, then how will we know? See, if you are not vigilant, you are in the boat, and thoda thoda pani aa raha hai niche se, you are not checking. You are still going in the boat. When it becomes too much water in the boat, and the boat starts going dagmag and then capsize, then it's too late, right? Therefore, it's better to check the small leakage before it becomes a flood. And that is the point of this Kaupin Panchakam. Before it becomes a flood. Then, next line. Pani dvaye bhoktu mamantra yanta. So beautiful. Using your two hands, pani is hands, right? Using your two hands as an eating vessel. S- some of you were with me when we went on a yatra. Vanbhog. What was it called?
Orissa.
Konark, na?
Konark.
Yeah, Sun Temple. So we went on a yatra. Where were we?
The Konark Temple.
Puri. Yeah, but Puri, from Puri. From Puri, how many of you were there? Wow, quite a lot. So, we went on a picnic. Picnic means we went to see the Konark Sun Temple. And we, Swamiji said, we will have one bhoj. One bhoj means picnic. But there, no vessels are taken. You have to eat however much fits in your palm. Huh? So, generally it might be, we had puri bhaji. It could be dahi bhat. So you put that in your palm. Then he, Swamiji explained all this to us. You might put papad in between your fingers. Then you might put one pakoda. Pickle. Then you might put some pickle. So whatever. You put like this and then you eat it. So, of course, we could go for seconds, you know. But generally, a bhikshu, when they are going to get bhiksha, they're not going to sit, that person is going to give, then he's going to stand there and eat. Then he said, can I please have a second helping? No. The renunciate will just get what fits in his two hands. And that's all for the day. For the day. He is satisfied. He has to be satisfied. That's all he's going to get. Okay? Be content. What this verse is saying. Be content with whatever fits in the palm of your hand. Not literally. But how much you require to exist. And you know, the renunciate has to beg from door to door. Why yes? Why this horrible practice? Why should he have to beg for his food? You know, when I took sannyas the first time, I was supposed to go and beg. Mukund, I asked that question. Why should she beg? Did you not ask that question? I remember it so clearly. Why? Like, I remember that question. I remember your one question. Why bhajans? Some questions cannot go from my mind. So, you are now become a sannyasi. You should have humility. You should have humility that if I have to beg also, kya jata hai mera? Nothing. I have to beg. Because nothing is mine now. If someone gives me, good. And if someone doesn't give, then also good. And he can only go to the door and say 3 times, bhiksha de, bhiksha de, bhiksha de. If after 3 times they do not come out and give, he has to go away from there. He cannot ask a 4th time. So this is good for the sannyasi because it develops humility. But let me tell you, it is also very important for the grihastha. Because for what reason? When he gives to the sannyasi, his pap karma gets diminished. So it is actually, he is coming to your door so that your pap gets over. And we think we are doing some great seva by giving them food. How our Vedas and our teachings we have lost it, you know. Nobody is here to teach all these things. Nobody is guiding us these days. We are living kuch alag hi. We have no concept of all this. So, this verse or this line in this verse is talking about attachment. Not only we are attached to our food, we are attached, right? We are attached to food. We are so picky about what we eat. It should be tasty. It should be different dishes every day. Different masalas should be used. Different cuisines. Aaj Indian khaya, to kal Italian khana chahiye, then Mexican khana chahiye, then Chinese hona chahiye. Or we want more menus, exciting menus. We want different things. Oi, dal chawal, every day dal chawal, what do you... And you know how much effort it takes to make dal chawal every day? How dare you question the food that is being prepared. How dare you? Not only we question the food that is being prepared, we even look down on it. I'm telling you, guys, this is mahapap. This is mahapap. When the food comes, you don't know. Bhagawan has sent that food. Bhagawan has sent that food. Whatever it is, you should feel blessed to receive it. Instead of complaining whether it is this dal roti again and this again and that again. And how much food we waste. Huh? Dharadhar we put in the plate, then we cannot finish it. And especially when we go for buffet. Buffet means cow, you know, like you are not eaten for God knows how many years. Why? Paisa diya na, paisa vasool karna hai, paisa vasool karna hai. 400 rupiya diya? 400. Khao. Such a waste. And we are not grateful for that also. So check it out. Fifth checkpoint. And be honest, how grateful are you for the food you get? How much of a slave are you to your taste buds? And one thing I would like you to write down and keep in front of you on your dining table where you sit. Am I grateful to the person who has made this food? All right. Lots of stuff, huh? All right. Kantham api stri miva kutsayanta. A renunciate, a sannyasi, a renunciate is as unattached, he's as unattached to a quilt. Quilt, you know, rajai. He is as unattached to a quilt as he is unattached to a woman. Imagine he is sleeping under a tree. Right? Open air. Weather may be hot, weather may be cold. He doesn't have, you know, temperature control with the AC. He doesn't have some nice blankets. He has what he has. If he has some kapda, he will odo. If he doesn't have, and you know what, I'll tell you. Once, I was coming back from a flight from America. I had just gone to leave Maya and Nikhil to college. You know, they had both gone on the same day, like same trip, same year. And I had not traveled much in those days, and we didn't have much money also in those days. So whatever, you know, foreign exchange I had, I just left it with them. Huh? And now I'm just going back home. I have to get on the flight. On the flight, I will get food. Then I'll get down at home. And then why do I need any more money? So I didn't keep any money with me. It just so happened that the same night when the flight was to leave from New Jersey, Diana, Lady Diana, had an accident and she died. So the flight which was to come from London to pick us up from New Jersey did not come because all flights, everything was cancelled. And I was stuck at the airport. I was so buddhu at that time. I didn't even know that I could go to the airlines and get a food coupon. So I just sat there. I was shivering. It was cold. for 2 nights almost we stayed in the, I did a long story but I'm cutting it short, and I was feeling so cold, and we had to keep all our luggage with us also because they didn't even check us in. So what I would do is I would go into different parts of the airport and find newspapers that people had left, and I would take the newspaper and cover myself and lie down. So I'm thinking of that when the renunciate is feeling cold and is sleeping under the tree, he must be also finding leaves and finding some kachra bachra here there and making himself. He's unattached. He is not. What we need to sleep, we need a particular pillow. If that pillow is not there, neend nahi aati hai. You know, I know people who carry their pillows with them abroad also. If your mattress is not of that particular whatever, maybe you need a fluffy one or you need a very firm one or you need whatever you need. If you don't have that, please go and find one like that for me. I can't sleep. We're like that princess and the pea. So these are your bondages, guys. These are the bondages. What other bondages are there? When we say we are bound, we are bound by our own greeds or our own needs which are irrational. If a renunciate can sleep, कहीं भी जगह मिला सो गया, and you know he is so tired, his sleep will come in 1 minute. With all our comfort, नींद नहीं आती है. Why? Because this is not relaxed. This is not relaxed. So we have to take goli. Then 12 baje, 1 baje neend aa jati hai. Then because of that we can't wake up in the morning. Because of that we can't do sadhana, because then we have to rush to work. See where this bondage is. It's a vicious circle. And do we want to continue to live like this, or we want to find a different way? This is bondage, means you are the slave. Now why as unattached to a quilt as to a woman? Why that to a woman? Now feminists will say, why woman? Lots of advice has been given in Vedanta, again to explain the sex urge. It's natural, it's there for a purpose, because you have to bring new souls into the world. But we have engaged in this activity not just for that reason, and we are engaged in it to satisfy our lust. So once that function of bringing in the new souls is over, you no longer want to bring in souls, then if you are continuing this activity, and everyone knows what activity I'm talking about, then you are wasting virya. You are wasting virya. When you waste virya, you are doing something which is detrimental to your spiritual progress, because virya is also energy. And when you save that virya, sperm we are talking about, it gets converted, sublimates into ojas, into spiritual energy. There is no extra energy coming in from anywhere else. It is that same energy which rises and becomes your spiritual energy. Therefore, a brahmacharya or a person who is a renunciate, who is chosen, who has chosen to follow this path, he has to conserve the virya. So that is why a renunciate is not attached to the woman. He has to give up that attachment. So that is why we are talking about. We keep saying, kaam nahi hona chahiye, kaam nahi hona chahiye. Kaam meaning lust, desire. But how will it go? Because it is such a basic biological function. It cannot go until and unless you sublimate it with Bhagwan. You have to convert Kaam into Ram. If you can convert Kaam into Ram, Ram meaning what? Bhajan. Contemplating on Bhagwan. If you can convert that, Kaam has absolutely no chance of winning this battle. Because Ram is obviously Bhagwan, much more powerful. But you need to do that, Purushart. What we try to do, if you try to chop a tree by just cutting the leaves, or you want to chop a tree and you just cut the branch, will the tree get chopped? No. You have to uproot it, otherwise it will keep growing. So what we are doing is we are trying to get rid of chotu motu here, there. We are not going to the roots to take it out. So if you are interested in this, going the full journey of this spiritual thing, then you have to cut it at the root. What is that cutting at the root? Who am I? That contemplation has to come. That contemplation has to come. And what do I want? Is my goal more important? Or is this momentary bodily pleasure more important for me? And what do I actually want? That little bit of vivek has to happen. Right, so big question is, do I want to be a sansari or do I want to be a sannyasi? And you know, sannyasi and sansari is all in the mind, okay guys? It's not about giving up your clothes, it's not about giving up your home, it's not about giving up your family, it's not about giving up your business, profession, it's your mental state, it's your swabhav, it's your acharan. Are you getting stuck in any vishay? Sixth checkpoint.
Are you getting stuck at
any? In any vishay. What is your, you know, we all have a particular vishay which is pulling us more than, I mean, you know how we say patatavada. So everyone's patatavada is different. And if so, what are you doing to get unstuck? Or you're just doing, okay, glad acceptance. I'm stuck in this vishay. Glad acceptance. Is that the correct use of glad acceptance? No. Is this vishay being stuck here? Is this for me? Is this good for me? Is this what I want? I may want it, but is it in my highest interest? Is it priya or shreya? So, recap of second verse. If you're unattached to the vishayas, right? What makes you a Kaupin mantra? Are you unattached to the vishayas? Are you totally content with what you have? If so, you're a Kaupin mantra. So, how many up to now are Kaupin mantras? Out of 15, maybe we'll have 15 checkpoints. At least one or two, though, you will have a tick, na? Hopefully. Okay. Third verse. Dehabhimanam pahiridhya duradatmanam atmanyavalo kayanta aharnisham brahmaniye ramanta. When you chant this third verse, the first two lines, na, don't keep a gap. Because here I put it on another line just for the chand, but actually the word is together. Duradatmana. It will be one word. Okay? That's why I don't give a break. Deyabhimanam. Pariritya durad. Okay, up to there if we take, witnessing the body from far. So the earlier verse was talking about attachment. Attachment to vishay, attachment to people, attachment to situations, attachment to sansar. Difficult enough, right? Would you agree? Difficult enough. Because we try so hard and we still remain entangled. But now Bhagawan Adi Shankaracharya is saying, not only you have to get detached from people, not only you have to get detached from vishay, not only you have to get detached from situation, now you have to get detached from your own body. Deha abhiman. Deha means what? Body. Abhiman. Pride in your body. We are all entangled in I am the body. Yes or no?
Yes.
But a true renunciate, he does not have ownership of the body. And if he doesn't have ownership of the body, he has no ownership of the actions performed by the body also. If there is no aham, then who is doing the action? He cannot have the bhokta bhav because he doesn't have the karta bhav. So what does he do with his body? He uses it. He uses it to do the duties. He uses it to practice dharma. He uses it to do his responsibilities. It's almost like if you have a big load of things to shift from one place to another place, what will you do? You'll hire a truck, right? So the sannyasi hires this body to take things from place to place. That's it, it's like a truck or a suitcase or a trunk, but not his own. He has hired it from Bhagwan. Okay? We are saying he doesn't have any ownership of the body, but still he says, I am eating, I am talking, I am coming, I am going. Why does he say that if he doesn't believe he is I? Vyavahar. For Vyavahar. To make himself understood. I wrote one sentence. If he didn't say, I am talking or I am seeing, what would he have to say? See, I wrote it down. He would have to say, the vritti in my antakaran has perceived this object through the sense organ of sight. If he doesn't want to use the word I am seeing, he would have to say, vritti has risen, then it has gone out of my indriya, then, and whose indriya? I don't even have indriya. So for the sake of vyavahar, he is saying I, but he doesn't believe that I am the body, I am the mind, I am the intellect. Now when we practice witnessing, you all tell me some examples of witnessing. Give me one or two examples of witnessing. What would you witness?
Table is.
Table. The table. Table is here. Okay then. What do you witness? When would you use witnessing?
All the time. And when, so when you're looking at it, it's always...
When you're looking at something, it is there.
Yeah.
What about when somebody is being bad to you?
Then also you,
then also you should be witnessing.
Yes.
If it is raining, witness. If the sun is very hot, witness. If the road is dirty, witness. If your sofa has got spillage of food on it,
then also witness.
Clean it, but.
So basically, I'm not saying we witness it, but we are supposed to witness, okay? We are supposed to witness. So we take witnessing as witnessing something out there. But Bhagwan is saying, start witnessing yourself. And once in Siva, during Bhagavad Gita, I had made you all do this sadhana. I had got so many confusing questions about it. I told you, if you're sitting, witness your body is sitting. Do you remember this sadhana? If you're eating, just witness the taste, just witness the breathing, just witness your own self. If you're thinking something, witness that. If you're getting up, witness. Bhagawan is saying, witness your own body. Witness not somebody else's behavior which is bad. Witness your own thoughts. Witness your own desires as they're rising. Witness your own anger, not somebody else's anger. That will get rid of Deha Abhiman. If he's feeling hungry, thirsty, tired, sleepy, pain in the leg, pain in the head, pain in the various parts of the anatomy, what will the renunciate do? Witness. No reaction. No reaction. Just witness. And what allows him to witness all this? He knows that this body is an equipment which has got six modifications. Remember, six vikars. It's conceived, it's born, it grows, it matures, it decays, it dies. It is supposed to go through all these things. So what is there? What is the new thing in that? He witnesses all the six changes. Therefore, there is no need to react. It is temporary. Body is temporary. It's just a dress, you know. Just like you'll go home, you'll take this dress out. At some stage, you'll take the dress, body dress out. So no need to get attached to it. No need to get attached to it. Seventh checkpoint. Are you witnessing your body sensations? Are you witnessing your emotions? Anger, boredom, are you witnessing your thoughts? These are subtle things. I'm not telling you all to do everything. I'm telling you what the renunciate does. Then it goes on. Atmanam atmanyavalokayanta. The Atma sees the Atma. The Atma sees the Atma. See, when you're witnessing, you need a subject and an object, right? Mm-hmm. Only if there's a subject, you can witness the object, correct? Mm-hmm. Even when you're witnessing your own body, the witness is the subject and the body is the object, correct? Mm-hmm. Atma is the witness, emotion is the object. Atma is the witness, thought is the object, right? But for a renunciate, there is no BMI left. He doesn't think of body, he doesn't think of mind, he doesn't think of intellect. That no longer exists for him. So then what is he witnessing? There is only Atma. So the Atma is only seeing the Atma. There is no body, I'm witnessing body. No, where is body? This is illusion. Where is thought? It's a modification, it's an energy. What is energy? Energy is that only. So everything is that only. I am that. That is a concept here. There is nothing but that. So if I am witnessing my own body also, am I the body that I am witnessing? No, I am not. There is no body. I am Atma, right? There is no other thing but Atma. So Atma only can be witnessing, but what can he be witnessing? Atma only. That that is why death is not a subject of dukkh for the renunciate. Because for the sannyasi, when we do our sannyas diksha, our ceremony, we have already done the funeral of this body. For us, this body is considered gone. So death is not something to be dukhi about. In fact, it's a freedom because you are no longer contained in this jail. Already performed the funeral rites. So now what is there to be dukhi about? What is left? Only Atma. So Atma sees Atma only. How do you see yourself? Eighth checkpoint. And here you have three options of how you can see yourself. You can see yourself as BMI, body, mind, intellect. Or you can see yourself as BMI plus Atma. Most of us see ourselves like that, BMI plus Atma. But there's a third option, see yourself only as Atma. Interesting. Or one more line. Aharnisham brahmaniye ramanta. Day and night. The renunciate is delighting in Brahmic bliss. Day and night. If anyone wakes you up day and night, you will not have any problem in remembering you are a man or a woman. Would you? Do you have to do any sadhana to remember that? Do you have to do jap? I am woman. No, it is there. It's a nishtha. You are firmly established in that nishtha. I am man or I am woman. You don't need any part, any mala, any sadhana. Even people who have amnesia, loss of memory, they may forget their name, but they still will know that they are a man or a woman. Yes or no?
Yes.
That there is no doubt about it. In the same way, the jnani knows Aham Brahmasmi. Now he doesn't need to do any japmala for that. Now he doesn't have to do any sadhana for that. He is firmly established in Aham Brahmasmi. And that gives him bliss. Day and night. Established in Brahmic bliss. Then someone will say, well, I also read that on internet. I also know Aham Brahmasmi. I also know. But he has to have the direct experience of it, which just directly erupts like a volcano from inside you. That direct experience, then you will have that nishtha. So check it. Ninth point. What is your default setting? Because we play many roles, you know, and some roles are more important to us. So it could be, I am a man or a woman. Or is your default setting, I am a mother or I am a father? Because sometimes mother role is more predominant. Or for some people, it may be the default setting, I'm a husband or I'm a wife. So spouse could be your default setting. For some people, your profession may be your default setting. I'm a doctor. That's the most important role you are playing. Or I am a teacher, or I am an architect, or I am a guru. There is no end to those things. It happens for everyone. So check that out. What is your default setting? Because that default setting is preventing you from getting the nishtha, aham, brahmas. So that's the third verse. If you're just witnessing your body with the six vikars, if you're seeing yourself as atma, witnessing atma, if day and night you have the nishtha, aham, brahmasmi, then you are Kaupinavanta. And what are you doing? Halu Bhagyavanta. Okay? Next verse. Now they will be short because moti baat to ho gayi. Let's chant. Fourth verse.
Svananda bhave paritushtimanta svashanta sarve नान्तं न मद्यं न भविस्मरन्त कौपीनवन्त खलु भाग्यवन्त.
फर्स्ट लाइन स्वानन्द भावे परितुष्टिमन्त. टोटली कंटेंट इन द सेल्फ. टोटली कंटेंट इन द सेल्फ. So, we need many different things to be content. And then also, we are not content. We need clothes, different colors, different styles, different fabrics, different designers. See, Samrita, you know, in the beginning when I took Sannyas, she was in... took the responsibility of making my clothes. So the only thing I told, they have to be this color. So, and I told, give one pattern. And every time some different pattern would come. So I said, why this different? No, why same you will be wearing? So I said, I don't want different pattern. Because I don't want the headache of thinking which pattern shall I wear. Already I was relieved of which color to wear. Already I was relieved of, you know, what to wear, which style. Now I have to think, no, this neckline is like this, or this sleeve is high or low. Give me one thing, I pick up blindfold from the cupboard and wear it. Like that. We need all these things. So it needs to be different. Clothes, food, exotic ingredients, different taste buds have to tingle. And vacation also, we can't go to same place. Are wahan to gaye the last year. Somebody said like for our 15th August. Are this place to we went last year, so I'm not coming because same place. So we need all this, you know, choices and pickles now, you know. People give up spirituality of a pickle, now what shall I do? Then different TV programs have to be there, you know. We have to be entertained. Some different program, different movie. Friends also have to keep changing. But renunciate needs absolutely nothing. Why? He doesn't need to be entertained. Where is his entertainment? Are andar hai sab. He's carrying it with him. He doesn't need to go to the villa on the edge of the sea, on top of the mountain. Huh? Any place, he's carrying his happiness with him. No faraway places, Anju. no far away places. No need to go in the, what you all go? Cruise. Or vaha, you know, you have to have different entertainers every night. Entertain myself, no problem. His source of entertainment is also inside him. His source of solace is also inside him. Shanti. Kaha jana hai? Upar, where nobody lives, there I will go. No, no need. Even in the busy marketplace, this place is there where he'll get shanti. Even in the bazaar, even in the railway station, even in the marketplace, this place is right here, right now. Check for yourself. 10th thing. What is your go-to place? Where do you have to go when you're disturbed? Spa.
Tuma.
Ma is your spa. Yeah, maybe I should put that on my card. Spiritual spa.
I sound very dirty.
I bet there'll be somebody on the internet with that. I can bet it.
Come have your soul massage.
Soul massage.
I saw you
well.
Not this.
What kind of food do you need? What kind of clothes do you need? Chocolate when I'm feeling stressed? Do I need, a drink? That's a common one. I need a drink. I'm so stressed. Okay, whatever. It's okay. They don't know how to drink their own nectar. Then they have to drink from outside. Know what to do. And then we have a provider also over here. And then you need some diamonds also. So we have somebody to supply that also. I never understand one thing. Abroad it happens, not here. But we don't have that custom. The guy has to propose to the woman. Then he has to go down on one knee. Then he has to open that ring box. Then she will see the size of the diamond and decide whether to marry him or not. So, it all depends on how big the diamond is. Huh? Then I will marry, if not. No, I don't think. I don't think I can live with you. This diamond is too small. What all we need, I tell you.
Going on one knee is okay, na? Humility at least.
Is that so? But then what happens after she accepts? Then never on one knee.
Then
she is
always on
the other. Then she has to be on. Now this is going in a different place. Alright, next line. Svashanta sarvendriya vritti mantaha. Indriya, vritti, what does it mean? You know these words, right?
Yes.
All the sense organs are withdrawn. Because from the sense organs, your vrittis, your thought vrittis rise. So all the sense organs have been withdrawn. Why do we feel so good after a good night's sleep? Have you ever thought about it? Sense organs are closed. When sense organs are closed, mind is also closed. When mind is closed, intellect is also resting. Where are you at that moment? In the Atma. There is no disturbance. You are actually, what you are doing is you are taking a dip in the Atma, which is not getting disturbed by all these veils, by all these barriers of Indriya, Man, Buddhi. All are Shant. We are talking about deep sleep state, Sushupti, not in dream state. Those who don't go into deep sleep state don't wake up fresh the next morning. So if you are not waking up fresh in the morning, it means your sleep has not gone into deep sleep state long enough. And do you know when it doesn't go into deep sleep state? When you take sleeping tablets. You think you are taking a sleeping tablet to go into deep sleep state. Actually, it is not happening at all. Actually, you are going into tamas. You are going into tamas. So, when all these indriyas, man, buddhi are shut down, contact with the outside world has stopped. Because indriyas is the first place from where the outside world enters our mind. Correct? But for a renunciate, does he need to do that only in sleep? We can only close this in sleep. But renunciate, it's already withdrawn. It's fully trained. He has fully trained buddhi, man, indriya to be antarmukhi. For us, all this is bahirmukhi. We are continuously using it to function outside. But a sannyasi, a renunciate, a jnani, he has already trained. He can be with eyes wide open, but he is antarmukhi. He can be doing any job, any work, he can be having a meeting, he could be doing a pravachan, but he is established inside. Established inside. He uses his indriya when he needs to. He uses his man when he needs to. He uses his buddhi when he needs to. But when it's not needed, he puts it inside. It's beautiful. At his will, he can use these things. It's like you have a mobile phone. Do you continuously look at it? Yes, some of you do. But otherwise, when you need to make a call, you use it. When you need to make some message, you use it. Otherwise, you put it down. Same way, we have to use these faculties, organs of action, organs of perception. When you need them, you use them. They are your tools. Will a carpenter 24/7, will a carpenter carry his hammer and his screwdriver and his saw and his whatever plinth and whatever they use, will just continuously carry all this? No. When he has a job, he will pick it up and he will use it and then he will put it down. We must also learn to put it down. Put what down? This man. This indriya, this buddhi, don't become their slave. Use it. Let them work for you. When you have a particular favorite vishay in front of you, fatak, out. Indriya bhi gaya, man bhi gaya, buddhi bhi gaya, sab gaya, bahar. We did no last time. In Bhagavad Gita. So which Visha is pulling you out? Check it. Number 11. And become a little aware now. When you are tired, when you are stressed, just check, was it too much of interaction baharmukhi? This is just like, you know, becoming more and more aware of what you are doing and your state and how you are living and where were you supposed to be going and where are you going now? Alright, and then he concludes this verse by saying, Nantam namadhyam nabahismaranta. Not bothering with the anta, end, not bothering with the madhyam, middle, na bahi, not bothering with the outside world at all. So not bothering with the end of the world, nor the middle of the world, or the outside, anything of the outside world, not bothering. So should you not bother with anything? Should you not bother with your health? Should you not bother with your family? Should you not bother with your job? Bothering means worrying. Not worrying about these things, okay? Not that you should let it go to rot. Of course, you have to take care, you have to do your dharma. But not worrying. We don't, we worry. The most useless activity in the world, worry. So most people are spending their time worrying. Anta, future. And if they're not worrying about the future, they're regretting the past. And if they're not worrying about the future and regretting the past, what are they doing? They're totally engrossed in the present outside world. No time for the inside world. The renunciate is not worried at all. What do we mostly worry about? Death, 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 death. Biggest worry, death. But renunciate knows what is going to die. Body. Where will it go? Back to Panchbhut from where it came? Earth will go to earth. Water will go to water. Fire will go to fire. Air will go to air. Akash will go to Akash. What have I to worry about that? It is come from there. I did not bring it. It came. Like that only nature will take it back. And I am Atma. Where will I go? Paramatma. Kya worry karne ka hai? No need to worry about it. So no need to regret the past. It's dead. It's finished. You made some mistakes. Okay, you made. Because you didn't know better at that time. But now you know. Now if you make a mistake, it's a problem. When you made a mistake, when you didn't know all this, no problem. It's okay. But after knowing, if you're still doing the same things, then it's a problem. Because then you really don't have a goal to which you have dedicated your life. So outside world is there. You need it for vyavahar. Treat it for vyavahar. Just like when you want the indriya, man, buddhi, you use it. When you don't need it, you put it down. When you need the outside world, you use it. When you don't need it, put it down. Then where will you go? Inside. If you don't put that down, how will you go inside? Whole time we are just engrossed in vyavahar only. So don't worry about end, don't worry about middle, don't worry about anything. You have everything with you, guys. You have everything within you. Just you have to look for it. You have to remove the obstacles which are in the way. That's it. Check out. Are you worried about anything? What are you worried about? Do you regret anything? What are you regretting? Drop it. Focus. Focus on what is important in your life. So that's the fourth verse. Are you totally content? Are your sense organs withdrawn? If you're not bothered about past or future, then you are Kaupin Vanta. And Khalu Pakka, you are Bhagyavanta, you are fortunate. And then comes the last shloka. And you must be thinking, thank God. Because so many things I have to now think about. And that also is not compulsory. Fifth verse.
Panchaksharam pavanam uncharanto patim pashunamaridi bhavayanta bhishashanati shupari pramanta kaupinavanta kalubhagyavanta
panchaksharam pavanam uncharanto. Chanting the sacred five-letter mantra, Panchakshar, five-letter mantra, what is that? Namah Shivaya. Panchakshar. Does it, huh? But the actual mantra is Namah Shivaya. So, is it necessary that all renunciates have to do this Panchakshar? No, it's a sample. It's like a one thing they have said. You have to chant what? Guru Mantra. It may be Panchakshar, it may be 11 Akshar, it may be whatever Akshar. You have to chant Guru Mantra. So why should you continuously be chanting? What is the reason? We to do one jap and then next day we do hopefully one more. But renunciation is sada, sada. Why sada?
We don't know the last moment of death.
Correct. We won't know which is the last moment. And last moment of before death
leads,
decides your gati. So last moment before death, Bhagwan's naam should be on your lips. But Bhagwan's naam will not be on your lips if your whole life, it has not become your default setting. You remember, dukaan mein kaun hai? So, if you're not going to be worried about dukaan mein kaun hai at the time of your death, because the whole life you have been thinking of your dukaan, business, paisa, then make your default setting the mantra that the guru has given you. Also, the mind by its nature, the swabhav of the mind is to jump from place to place, right or wrong? It's a default setting. So if you don't give it any job, it will go wherever it wants. And renunciate knows that, sannyasi knows that, jnani knows that. So to give the man something to engage it, what other thing is better than Bhagwan's naam jap. So as you're wandering in the outside world, if you're cooking, if you're sweeping, if you're writing, if you're bathing, see how beautiful the rishis are. Their thinking is so beautiful. They have made mantras for every single activity in the day. So when you wake up, kara agre vasati lakshmi. You step on the floor, Prithvi Tvaya. You have the Prithvi mantra. You go for bath, bath mantra. You go for food, Annapurne. You start any work, you think of God. You finish any work, every day and every minute, for every function, you have a mantra. Why? Stop this chanchal man from taking any other vikar. That vritti must be stuck on Bhagwan. That is why. Why? Because my gati depends on that. My next life or my kalyan depends on that. So what thought is constantly in your mind? Wherever it is, try to become aware. Whenever put something, you know why this kalava is put here? it's to remind you. See, when you're eating also you will see it. Your hand is the thing that does most of the action. Whenever you do something, you'll see it. Make this kalava or whatever else you want to, a reminder, what am I thinking right now? What am I thinking right now? And whatever I'm thinking, bring it back to Bhagwan. Then, patim pashunam ridhi bhavayanta. Beautiful. It means keeping the image of Paramatma in your heart. Heart we associate with what?
The spiritual
love.
Love. So what is Paramatma? Paramatma is made of the essence of love. What kind of love? Unconditional love. What kind of love? Infinite love. It doesn't end. It doesn't need to have a condition. Because conditional love is not infinite. Conditional love is, you do this for me, you obey me, you like me, you do as I say, you take care of me, I like you. In a minute you stop doing anything nice for that person, I hate you. Where did the love go? So Paramatma's love is not like that. Paramatma's love is infinite. It never ends. And it's unconditional because it doesn't depend on any other condition. And Atma, you know, is the same as Paramatma. Yes or no? Is there any difference in Atma and Paramatma? And you are what? Atma or BMI?
Atma.
Now see the logic. You are Atma. Atma is Paramatma. Paramatma is infinite love. So who are you? You are infinite love. You are unconditional love. That is your essence. What have you done with that love which is actually your nature? You have cut it. Swamiji gives this example in Bhagavat. He says, you were given this infinite, unconditional love. Who you are. Then what you did? Uska thoda tukda diya parents ko. Usse thoda kam diya spouse ko. Bada tukda diya bachcho ko. Huh? One slice for friends. Lots of different pieces for different vishayas. And you generously dole it out, you know, when it is required. When the children require, you give it. When children don't behave, you take it back. When spouse is nice to you, you give it. Spouse is not nice to you, you take it back. Huh? Parents, till they are nice to you, you give it. When they act too troublesome, you take it back. And you have just cut up this love into different portions, into different compartments, into different boxes. Are, where is the love for Paramatma gone? You have given it all to the Vishayas. Because all these different people I said are also Vishay only. Nothing baki left for Paramatma. What to do? Take it back from everyone? Should I stop loving my spouse? Should I stop loving my children? Should I stop loving my parents? Should I stop loving anything? Take all the love back? Be selfish? Love only myself? No! Love only Paramatma, because everyone is the same Paramatma. If you love Paramatma, you'd be loving everyone. Because Paramatma is in everyone. There is nothing but Paramatma. So love everyone, but love the divinity in them. Don't love the body. Don't love the actions of that person. Don't love the gifts of that person. Love the Paramatma of that person. Love the divinity in that person. And that's the only way you can love unconditionally. Otherwise, all love is conditional. Right? So this distribution system has to be changed a little bit. Keep some for Paramatma also. And where to put that Paramatma? Riddhi, in the heart. In the heart. From where? Which heart? The one that pumps? Blood. Then what will happen? You'll get a cut, then Paramatma will bleed out. Do you know, when we say heart in spirituality, it's not here, by the way. It's not here. It's wrong. It's not here. It's close to the buddhi. Where is the buddhi? Where is the buddhi? Here, khopdi mein. Everywhere. Everywhere. So it's, but they say that in some books you will read, even in Atma Bodh, I think it's there, I'm not sure, that the Atma is the size of a thumb and it's in the cave of the heart and all that. It's a way of making it tangible for you to understand. That's
it's in
all. Vivekachudam. Vivekachudam, correct. So, 14th checkpoint. Do you give your love freely? Do you give your love freely? When do you withdraw it? Enough for you to check that much, then you will know. And then the last line.
Nishashanadikshu pari brahmanta.
Roaming around. Brahmanta. The Kaupin Vanta is roaming around everywhere just on the bhiksha that he has got. Just on the alms. A-L-M-S. Alms. Just on whatever he gets, he is simply roaming around. So how many of you all came with me to Kailash Mansarovar? Also quite a lot. So when we went to Kailash, we had many yatras, but Kailash I'm talking about. We had a limitation of the baggage we could carry, right? Everything had to fit in one bag. That also the bag that they gave us. We could not take one big suitcase. One bag, just one bag. And that also was difficult to carry. And especially when we went into higher and higher altitudes, that bag also, thank God there was a Sherpa, thank God there were yaks to carry. We would not be able to carry. Okay. Then we went higher on the actual parikrama. Then even your water bottle was difficult to carry, right? All you could carry was that stick because it was helping you to walk. Even sweater nikala wo bhi Sherpa ko de diya because even carrying the sweater was burdensome. For a renunciate, all this stuff is a burden. As you go to higher and higher altitudes of spirituality, this stuff of the world is a burden. He will roam around on whatever he has in his patra. Then you'll notice, suddenly you'll feel, I can't bear all these clothes. You'll pack them up and you'll give them away to somebody. Because all these clothes also, I have no use of them. Or shoes or whatever, clothes, jewelry also, you'll give it away to your children, you'll give it away. All these things are burdensome. You'll want to be free because they have lost their attraction. Now you'll, sorry Gopal, but by that time now you'll see the diamond, you'll say, ye patthar kya hai? What is this? Just a patthar. It's just a patthar. is just shining. That's all. The attraction of these things have completely, you can't even understand why you loved it so much before. Roam around, free. Nothing, no need for 101 things of material world. Totally free, one loincloth, maybe one extra in case a rat eats it. One stick, one bhikshupatra, and he's set. Now, he doesn't have, the more worries we have. Huh? Now you have to be careful, where will I put my diamonds? I need a good safe, maybe someone will come and find the lock and open it. If you have a lot of stuff, you have to make sure you have watchman, security guard. See, in where I live, my neighbors, they need 10 watchmen for everything, you know. One person walks from one building to the next building, they have to be surrounded by 10 guards. Is that freedom? That's not freedom. But the renunciate is free, doesn't need anything, roam around freely. All this is your bondage. The day you will see it as bondage, that day you will be free. Till you can see it as bondage, you won't even realize you are bound. You won't even realize that these are binding me. So the last 15th checkpoint. How much baggage are you carrying? Do you feel free? So recap of the 15th verse. What is the default setting in your mind? Is it your guru mantra? Are you experiencing the infinite love of Paramatma in your heart? So many people joined us new on Zoom. They say, we can't identify with this bhakti, this Paramatma, and this love and all. What is this? We can't understand it. I said, don't bother to understand. Start doing karma yoga. Are you traveling light through the journey of your life? If so, then you are a Kaupin Vanta. Khalu Bhagyavanta. So that's Bhagawan Adi Shankaracharya's gift to us, to make us aware of where we are, to make us aware of where we need to go, which part of the journey are we on, and if we want to reach that state of Kaupin Vanta, then what are the things that are preventing us? What are the sadhanas we need to do to increase our vivek, our vairagya, test our progress, and then become truly Bhagyavanta? That's it. Even you have to change your thinking of what is Bhagyavanta. That first thing has to be changed. What is my thought? What is my concept of Bhagyavanta? That I have a beautiful house, I have all these, you know, beautiful things in it, I have artwork, I have children, they are studying in good colleges, and my spouse has got a good job, and we are getting so much of income in the family, we are Bhagyavanta. Have I trained my buddhi to have vivek, vairagya? Do I have kshat sampatti? Am I developing mumukshatva? Have I made my antakaran ready to receive knowledge? I have? Okay. Bhagyavanta. Your choice. You have two options of Bhagyavanta. And everyone should choose their own Bhagyavanta. And that's it. Kaupinavanta. Kulu Bhagyavanta. You want to sing it once?
Yes.
Vedanta Vakyeshu Sada Ramanto Bhikshana Matrena Chatushtimanta Ashokavanta Karunekavanta Kaupinavanta
Shut
Chidambaram. Jai Gurudev.
Jai.